All right, we are back with more interviews, and I am glad to have Hans here with me. Hans,
I'm glad to be here. Thank you.
Thanks for joining me again.
Yeah.
And, you know, we were just having a discussion on, there was a keynote this morning, and it was broadcast for the virtual audience, and one of the topics that's, I guess you could consider it a hot topic in general right now, is around, do testers have to be technical, and do they need more technical skills in order to be successful? And so maybe talking about the viewpoint on that, because there's and we should all note that this is a hot topic, so it means people are passionate on both sides of the fence on this one. And you may have even heard some of the folks I interviewed this morning mentioned, you know, if you don't have coding skills, you may be getting left behind.
Yeah, that is an interesting topic. We had two really great keynotes this morning. If you haven't seen them yet, try to catch them when they become available online. And I would say it was the best and the second best keynote I have seen in a long time. I'm not going to tell you what was the best and what was the second best.
You have to judge for yourself.
You have to judge it for yourself. And in the second keynote, there was a point made that testers need to get coding skills and move more and more to coding skills. Now, I do believe that is a practical thing to know and to do, and you can do some of your own automation, but I don't see it as much as a must-have. Mm-hmm. I much rather have a tester who understands domain knowledge, who understands testing techniques, who has a tester attitude, and then the coding, we can worry about that later. Mm-hmm. A tester can write the test in something like BDD or keywords, something that is away from the technology, and really put more effectiveness in the test itself.
Yeah. Well, and just the mindset, right? So, you know, when you look at, you know, we talk about passion's important, and you should be passionate about what you do, and we tend to do better when we're passionate. And, you know, if you ask someone who's passionate about developing, coding, building code, their passion may be different than someone who says, I'm passionate about testing, right?
Could you be, but there are people who are, but it's not standard, and it's not necessarily what I look for.
Right.
And I always think that it is also a matter of interest. Like I like to say that the developers are the people who like to create things, and the testers are the ones who like to destroy them.
Right.
And so that's more what I would call the dark side.
I don't
take that literally, of course, but it's a different way of thinking. And a developer will ask, what do I need to build? What does it need to do?
Yes.
Tester will ask, what can go wrong?
Yes.
What can I do to it to break it or to find the weaknesses, etc. And that's a great thing, because if you find those weaknesses, the earlier you find them, the easier they are to attend to.
Yes. Well, and I think that's a really good point. I've seen, you know, when you have testers, people who naturally have a testing mindset, they're testing boundaries, they're testing limits, they're figuring out what happens if a component doesn't work or if it breaks. It's almost this natural curiosity about how does it work and what makes it work and what makes it break. And then, as you mentioned, the developers are about, what do I need to build? I want to build something.
Yeah.
And we'll ask a question a lot of times when I've seen people get hired about, you know, if I gave you a washing machine, what would be your first instinct about what you would do with that, right?
Yeah.
And for a tester, it would probably be, I'm going to take it apart and see how it works, right?
Yeah.
And I'm going to, and then you would say, are you going to put it back together? And they'd probably be like, no, because if I took it apart, I know how it works, and I've taken all the pieces out.
Yeah.
Whereas the developer would say, now I want to put it back together, right?
Yeah,
and I want to build it, and I want to figure out how it works, and then make it work.
Yeah, remind me not to let you anywhere near my washing machine.
So I don't take it apart into little pieces and never put it back together. Exactly.
Yeah, and tester would think like, what if I do the washing machine upside down?
Right.
Does it still work?
Yeah, and can it run?
Not that you're going to do that every day, but there are such
unexpected
moves that you can think with a system under test, and you want to know whether that system survives it.
Right. Well, and you did mention too, I mean, there's a lot of options out there for folks like Cucumber and keyword driven frameworks. So there are options to use, and I've seen it in organizations, you know, and maybe give us your experience on this, where, you have folks that aren't necessarily coders who can use keyword driven or, you know, as you mentioned, the BDD or the cucumbers of the world to use common language as long as your syntax is correct, right? And you're using it in the correct way where it's English language and you can understand it, right? Yeah. It's understandable and readable.
Yeah, it is. You probably know that this is a good time to plug it. We have our own product, Test Architect, which works with keywords. I actually went ahead and made a tool that translates BDD sentences into keywords and back. So you can take the keywords and translate it back into BDD, make it very accessible for a wide range of stakeholders.
Yeah.
While at the same time, because it can be translated to keywords, it's easier to maintain and to organize than BDD scenarios tend to be.
Yeah.
And there is a lot less technical necessity, so you don't need Cucumber or anything to automate it.
Yeah. So this would maybe be good then in organizations out there where people are saying, I know I need to get some automation. I know we can't manually test everything, but we're struggling because our organization maybe doesn't have all the skill sets we need to be able to do all pure, you know, test automation frameworks that are coded from the ground up that don't have keywords or other components. So would this be a good case study maybe for someone out there who says, we really want to do something, we're not sure where to start. How easy is it to get started with something like the tool you guys created?
Technically easy. Mm-hmm. The technology is it's fairly straightforward. Mm-hmm. There can be kinks. Sometimes there are third party controls that is not supported, so you can run into trouble. But from a technical perspective, it's easy. But I would like you to focus on is the test design.
Mm-hmm.
And test design is always important. That really gives you good quality tests. But for automation, it's double important.
Yes.
The better your tests are organized, the easier it is to do what they call impact analysis. If there is a change in the application and the test, which test cases are affected.
Mm-hmm.
And the better those tests are organized, the better that goes. And so your maintainability of the test is not so much a technical challenge, it is more a test design challenge.
Yep. And so when you go into organizations that say, hey, we want to do this, is that where you start with them? You know, making sure that the test design is appropriate, correct?
Yeah, essentially. And like another big thing that I will look for is testability.
Mm-hmm.
Do the systems under test expose enough properties of screen elements, hooks to get to data that is being displayed, hooks for timing, if I fill up a table, when is the table complete, that kind of hooks, how easy it is to automate. And that those two together, test design and testability, give you a good handle on UI-based testing.
Mm-hmm.
And you are aware that test can go through the UI or you can go through an API. Mm-hmm. And nowadays that's often RESTful APIs.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a trend right now, it's called the testing pyramid. Mm-hmm. That you need to do as many tests possible at the unit test level. And then follow the component-based test. And then at the top, a very small area for UIs.
Mm-hmm.
I am not so sure that's true.
Mm-hmm.
I think the UI is where it all comes together
mm-hmm.
in your system, and I would recommend to give ample attention to make sure stuff works using the UI.
Mm-hmm.
The reason people avoid the UI is because it tends to be difficult.
Yeah.
And you may remember President Kennedy about the moon. He said that we're going to the moon, not because it's easy, but because it's hard.
Right.
And in my interpretation means you should avoid UI if you don't have to, but you should not avoid it because it would be difficult mm-hmm. to automate or difficult to maintain. If you organize your test well and your testability is in order and you cooperate well with your developers and others, UI automation should not be such a big problem.
Right.
Especially not web UIs.
Yeah. So again, for those folks out there who haven't seen it yet, that pyramid is really, I mean, people are talking about that a lot of, right, where do you focus? And especially for automation. And so I think that's a good point of, are we truly focusing on certain areas because they're the low hanging fruit and they're the easy areas?
Yeah.
Or are we focusing on them because it makes business sense?
Yeah, absolutely.
And where the impact is?
Absolutely. And just about unit tests. Unit tests have the tendency to be fairly elementary.
Mm-hmm.
Once they work, they work.
Mm-hmm.
They won't break again. Mm-hmm. They're very useful, but in my perspective, they're sometimes a little boring.
Yeah.
It's not really the most spectacular testing.
Yep.
While business-oriented tests, a more end-to-end test, where you really simulate real business situation that you devise together with a domain expert,
mm-hmm.
they can be very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
More exploratory, more rich. And that mm-hmm. is the kind of richness that you want in your test.
Yeah. Now, here this week, so you had a session on test automation.
Yeah.
Yep. What other sessions did you have this week or do you have coming up? Do you have more coming up this week?
No, just small things like there is the meet the speakers lunch. Tomorrow I will do a presentation in the test lab. So that's going to be cool.
Yeah. So the folks that don't know what that is, the test lab is here at the conference we've talked about before. So it's an opportunity. So there's a lot of sessions where you can get information and learn, but there's also a test lab where you can participate and actually hands-on work with things.
Yeah.
So you'll be giving a session in there.
Yeah, it's a very popular thing. And not because I do again, but it's a very popular part of this conference,
mm-hmm.
and it's really hands-on.
Mm-hmm.
And there are constantly very experienced people around
mm-hmm.
that will help you do this. And so, and that would be one of the main reasons for a next conference, not to just do the virtual one, but actually physically go to the place and do this.
Yeah, because you get an opportunity to hands-on use some of the things that people are talking about, see some new things, get exposure to some experts that may help you see it in a different light, you know, look at a problem a different way, those types of things. So that's a good recommendation for folks that haven't seen it. We will check in with them. They usually try and do something that our virtual audience can participate in.
Okay.
So I'll check and see if they've got anything for you guys out there in the virtual audience this year. But we try and engage you guys, and we've had a virtual audience winner before of some of the testing. So,
okay, that's cool.
So, yeah, we'll see if we can get that. Now, your day job is CTO, right?
LogiGear.
From LogiGear. Any big problems, challenges, what you're seeing as trends, you know, in that space?
Well, we live in interesting times.
Mm-hmm.
As you may know, that is an old, ancient Chinese curse.
Mm-hmm.
May you live in interesting times.
Exactly.
But I think we are, and I think it's very cool.
Yeah.
I think there is a lot of developments are coming together.
Mm-hmm.
The obviously hardware and cloud, and
mm-hmm.
the DevOps is very nice. Service-oriented architectures are mm-hmm. very cool with the microservices or the serverless compute, all that. So it's moving very rapidly, and we're happily moving along to deal with that.
Yeah.
So it's very interesting. Right now. It's a very interesting field to be in.
Yeah, fun to see the changes because they're coming a lot faster, right? The technology advancements are coming faster. Hans, thanks again for being with us. We're already out of time. If someone wants to find you, how do they do that?
Well, they can write me hans@logigear.com.
Perfect.
Or hans@happytester.
Happy Tester
is my site. It's just a single page site where I keep track of all my articles, all the things that I've written, the blogs. So you can, that's a kind of a one-stop point where you can see my stuff.
At Happy Tester or LogiGear. So Hans, thanks for being with us again.
Yeah.
Enjoy the next session coming up, and we'll be back with more interviews later.
Okay.